have 4 panelists today, and we'll have a conversation on state priorities and local opportunities and needs to improve coastal resilience between these 4 state leaders, specifically related to topics such as science, policy, guidance, and regulation. So first I'd like to introduce Jonathan Bishop, Chief Deputy Director of Water Resources Control Board. He has served as the chief at the State Water Board since 2007, where he oversees the Division of Water Quality and the Division of Financial Assistance, amongst other responsibilities. Next, we have Dr. Mark Gold, joined the Ocean Protection Council in July of 2019, and serves as the Executive Director of the Ocean Protection Council and the Deputy Secretary for Ocean and Coastal Policy for the California Natural Resource Agency. Dr. Gold serves as a key advisor to the Governor and the Secretary of Natural Resources and directs policy, scientific research, and critical partnerships to increase protection of coastal and ocean resources in California. Next, we have Madeline Cavalieri, Statewide Planning Manager for the California Coastal Commission. Madeline has served at the Coastal Commission for over 13 years, beginning in the Commission's Statewide Planning Unit, administering the Open Space Easement Program. She then was transferred to the Commission's North Central and Central Coast District offices as a coastal planner, and she was appointed District Manager of both of those in 2012, and in 2017 was appointed the Statewide Planning Manager. And last, we have Dr. Gary Griggs, Distinguished Professor of Earth Sciences, University of California, Santa Cruz, where he completed his 51st year at UC Santa Cruz and directed the campus's Institute of Marine Science for 26 years. He is also a member of the California Ocean Science Trust and the Science Advisory Team to the California Ocean Protection Council. So we are pleased to have these 4 panelists today to have a conversation about some of the priorities facing our state. So I have a question for all of you, and we can just start at one end and go from there of the table. So under the Newsom administration, what are the top priorities for each of your organizations related to coastal resilience? Maybe we can start with you, Jonathan.
If you're not familiar with the State Water Resource Control Board and the regional boards, we're a regulatory agency. We're not a planning agency or a land use agency. We regulate people. We tell them what to do. We like that. But coastal resilience is about a lot of different things. In our sphere of influence, it's about water reliability. And coastal infrastructure. And so we have, under the Newsom administration, we have a series of resiliency programs for both stormwater capture and infiltration, so to both protect the water quality and to improve our local water reliability. We're focused on the idea of capture and infiltration of stormwater. We have a huge water recycling. As you can imagine, under the way our infrastructure runs, it runs downhill. Wastewater treatment plants tend to be on the coast, and they have been historically discharging to the ocean. This is a opportunity for us to reduce the reliance on imported water by recycling and reusing that. So both on our water quality side and our drinking water side, we are emphasizing water recycling. We have regulations on indirect portable reuse, which is taking that recycled water and augmenting ground or surface water supplies. And we are on track to have a direct portable reuse program regulations out in a couple of years. We have, as mentioned in my bio, also have oversight of our financial assistance. We give out a lot of money every year, either in grants or loans. A lot of that is for infrastructure, things like water recycling plants and stormwater capture and use. So we are both looking at it from a regulatory side, ways to make sure that recycled water, stormwater capture is done effectively and safely, and on the financial side, to encourage investments. Unlike 50 years ago, when the wastewater infrastructure that our country, our state is built on was 85% done by the feds and the state, and then just 15% local, that is reversed now. So most of the money for any project has to come from local sources. We provide grants and loans, but it's never going to be enough. It has to be a part of that ticket. And so it means, as we move towards resiliency on the coast, it means that we have to acknowledge that that change in infrastructure is going to cost us all money. It's going to cost the locals ability to raise taxes and do that.
So in the previous administration, Governor Brown and even Governor Schwarzenegger obviously took extraordinary measures from the standpoint of reducing carbon emissions, and that was really the top priority. And so the state became a global leader on mitigation in that regard. But the Newsom administration is really looking at resiliency and adaptation as really being the top priorities of the administration, that those are the areas that need to be strengthened tremendously. And in particular, climate resilience for my boss, Secretary Wade Crowfoot, is one of his three top priorities, as well as access for all and biodiversity. So those are the stated top three for him. And so coastal resiliency is obviously a big part of that. So for us at the Ocean Protection Council, we're finishing up our strategic plan, which should be before the Ocean Protection Council itself for a vote on November 13th. And within that will be a climate section, which will include coastal resiliency recommendations. I wish they were more clear-cut than they are right now. I think a lot of this has to do with, because there has been a little bit less focus at the state level on this, other than the Coastal Commission, which has sort of been out on a limb for quite some time on dealing with this issue, almost one development or LCP at a time. From the standpoint of trying to develop a coastal resiliency policy of some sort, so there's some uniformity in at least an approach and how that's occurred. The OPC has really been there more to provide technical guidance on various different issues, and I think we need to get to the point where we're really working with our sister agencies, with the Coastal Commission and Coastal Conservancy and others, to work more on developing that policy. In particular, I can see us having an infrastructure action plan. To do that, I think the protecting infrastructure, I think, is going to be a lot more politically palatable to the public as a whole in moving forward on coastal resiliency. When you start dealing with people's individual homes, it gets a lot tougher. But when we're talking about what's going to happen to our water system, what's going to happen to transportation, et cetera, that's something that the public, I think, can relate to and understand the importance of and realize that they have to be part of this solution a lot more. One of the other things that I can see us overlapping quite a bit with Jonathan on is, you know, which I think is a real big part of resiliency, and we've seen this as a major problem in Monterey as well as in the South Bay in the LA area, is the impact on seawater intrusion. Which is only going to be exacerbated from sea level rise. And so that's already costing, you know, tens to hundreds of millions of dollars a year to keep our aquifers pure and not saline. And so that, I think, is just going to be an increasingly large issue that has to be dealt with. The other thing the state is working towards, and you probably read a lot about this in the last year and a half, is a resiliency bond. It's very likely, not certain, but very likely that there will be a resiliency bond on the ballot next November. So, you know, 14 months out or so. And in there, there will be probably a pretty significant coastal resiliency component to that, and things like wetlands and other factors will be in there that I'm sure we'll talk about more on in a few minutes. Because these issues are so complex and multi-jurisdictional, coordination of agencies has probably never been more important. And so I think that's something that our office is going to have to focus on a great deal, and making sure that we're not trying to deal with this complex problem in a siloed approach, but working much more closely together, hand in hand. And then we'll continue to keep funding research that's critical, that's applied, that's really going to help decision makers and managers make prudent decisions as quickly as possible.
As Mark alluded to, the Commission has been addressing coastal resiliency for many years. The Coastal Commission was created through a voter initiative back in 1972. The voters of California voiced their concern about coastal resources, how much they, you know, value public access and our coastal resources, habitat, and water quality. And there's definitely continued public support for protection of coastal resources. Under sea level rise, we know that we have an existential threat to those resources that we have to address. The Commission has done a great job protecting pieces of beach, pieces of wetland over the last 40 years. But how will the Commission protect access for all to a beach that might not be there in the future? Similarly, how can we protect wetlands that we know will be inundated? Our top priority, one of our top priorities, is addressing sea level rise through the lens of the Coastal Act and the coastal resource protection that the people of California have come to rely on for our beautiful coastline and access to it. So we are working closely with our local governments. We have 76 cities and counties up and down the state of California. Over 40 of them are working on local sea level rise planning. We have about $6 million of grants out to the communities, working first on vulnerability assessments, understanding and communicating about the impacts for the local community, adaptation plans, understanding what the options are, what the opportunities are for addressing those, and then getting LCPs updated. In addition to working with our local governments, we're also working closely with our state partners, with the Ocean Protection Council. We work very collaboratively on the new 2018 guidance that came out that aligns with what the Commission is doing, and so it's great to see that alignment among the state agencies, and also knowing that we're working with the best available science that's out there and the best tools that are out there. We're also working, with a bunch of agencies. I'll just mention two more. State Lands Commission, we're working very closely with to understand the public trust, which we know is migrating inland as sea level rises. And we know that we're gonna have to work together to protect public trust resources for the people of California over time. And then we also are working very closely with Caltrans and making sure that we're aligning the long-term highway planning with the long-term local coastal programs. The Caltrans is working very proactively in alignment again with those APC science guidelines to plan for the future of the state highway system. Thanks.
I think it's part of, our mission is education and research, and there's a wonderful quote from Nelson Mandela who said, the strongest tool we have for changing the world is education. And I think that goes to the heart of what we're talking about. This whole conference, there's a lot of misunderstanding today about what's going to happen in the future, what sea level is going to do. Eric added a lot of science to that, and I would dare to say the average person still doesn't understand too much, and there's lots of people who don't even believe it's happening. There's another great quote by Neil deGrasse Tyson who said, the wonderful thing about science is it's true whether or not you believe it. I think that's important to keep in mind. So, we have a big role. In addition to being on the Ocean Sciences Trust and the OPCSAT, we obviously have a role of education. And for me, I've now had 14,000 students over 51 years. I know there's at least one in the room, but there may be others. And we like to think that we've accomplished something in the 4 years. They give us thousands of dollars to be educated, and they go off more informed about what they're going to do in the future and what the world's issues are. And I'm going to just give you one example, and I like to think all my students have done this well. A woman who changed her major from taking my oceanography class 45 years ago and went on to become a chief scientist of NOAA, a space shuttle astronaut who went on 3 shuttle missions and was the first American woman to walk in space and launched the Hubble telescope, and then went on to become the administrator of NOAA, Kathy Sullivan. Now, I can't say it, all my other 14,000 students did that well, but you'd like to think that what we're imparting to those students is going to help them make better decisions in the future. So I think at all levels, though, education is something we all need to be aware of, and I think, again, there's some big gaps right now in what we know and what we believe and what we work with every day. Somebody once said, if you want to lose, I think it was Winston Churchill, if you want to lose all faith in democracy, talk to the average voter for 5 minutes. I think we all have a role to play.
All right. So, Madeline, what new policies and regulations can local governments anticipate in the future?
Local governments can anticipate perhaps some refinement of what the policy framework that we're working with right now, but also I think that they can anticipate more tools being available, more awareness building, more examples about how to truly engage communities in visioning for our future coastline, and then examples of plans for how to do that. Right now we're at a really challenging time. We have this really fundamental threat to our coastline that we've never dealt with before. We have our existing, the way that our existing policies and regulations work around land ownership, property rights, land use regulation, and those boxes, that framework that we've used for the past however many hundreds of years, don't fit neatly into our future reality, which is that our shoreline will be changing. Where the water meets the land will, in most cases, move inland. A lot of our low-lying areas, unfortunately, will be inundated not only by ocean waves, but also by groundwater coming up and inland flooding coming in. So we have, these fundamental changes that we're addressing. And I think that we have a framework in place. I mentioned working closely with the State Lands Commission on the protection of the public trust. The public trust has been around, I can't remember now, for hundreds of years, but the idea that we have this shared resource that should be protected for the public. And so how does that unfold in this new reality? I think what local governments can anticipate is that as we understand that better, as we move forward on this planning, there will be more examples, I hope more support, more funding mechanisms.
John?
When there are hard problems, we think about them ahead of time, we talk about them a lot, but they don't move until there's a crisis. We've talked about conservation in this state 30 years, as long as I've been involved. And it took a drought that caused communities to run out of water, for the first time that we can remember, to have the political will to actually impose conservation regulations. It took that drought to address groundwater extraction and overdraft of the signal regulations. My expectation is that it will take a either spectacular or serious seawater rise inundation of a wastewater treatment plant or infrastructure to provide the will to actually implement the plans that people have been thinking about for a long time. It seems counterproductive to wait for emergency, but everyone's has lots of priorities in their life, and this it takes something to galvanize people. And So I expect that we will continue to make incremental progress with stormwater capture, with recycling, but we will need something to galvanize the folks to make the major changes that are going to be needed.
Rooting for disaster, which I know is not exactly what you said, Jonathan, is certainly not the way to go. There's always a consequence. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the keynote speaker this morning, you could not have something more sobering to start the day from, and even makes you realize that some of the boldest recommendations might not be adequate to what we're really going to be facing in the next 50 to 100 years, and that's pretty critical. Some of the things that I'm starting to see, though, more and more in how we should be thinking about things, and I know State Water Board has been doing the same sort of thing and looking at this, is that, oh, we need to move towards water recycling, for example, we need water supply, right? And the drought really exemplified from the standpoint of a climate resiliency perspective why recycled water is so critical. You in Orange County take it for granted. You pretty much lead the world in this arena. It's not that way in the rest of the state of California. And so keep that in mind. But now we're also looking at, oh, well, water recycling is also going to help from the standpoint of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. It's also going to help from the standpoint of nutrient loading and organics loading, and potentially reducing the impacts of ocean acidification and hypoxia. And then on top of that, you know, there was just a release on microplastics, and, you know, the higher level of treatment, the less microplastics are end up getting discharged in the ocean. So now you have multiple reasons to do the right thing. Same thing goes for stormwater and low impact development, in that, you know, you're augmenting our groundwater supplies, you're reducing pollutant loads, and so there's multiple benefits of taking these sorts of approaches. In the case of coastal resilience as opposed to ocean resilience, you know, one example, and this is probably the safest example, so I'm not exactly sticking my head out too far, is wetlands. We've been talking about wetland restoration and wetland creation because we've lost 90% plus in the state of California forever, and we've been talking about that largely from a biodiversity perspective. Benefits to fisheries, benefits to a wide variety of migrating birds, as well as resident birds, et cetera, et cetera. Now, we talk about wetlands from the standpoint of carbon sequestration benefits. We're talking about wetlands from the standpoint of coastal resilience. And so if you look at the pace of wetland restoration and creation, especially here in the South Coast, it's pretty sad. You know, I know many of the wetlands that I started working on when I was a young grad student still have no progress. Ormond Beach and Biona Wetlands as examples. But you have seen this sort of acceleration that has occurred in San Francisco Bay on wetlands, and hopefully that will spill over to the Delta sometime soon, because there's an urgency on sea level rise that is being taken pretty darn seriously within that area that's not being taken as seriously down here. And so hopefully, you know, for that particular example, you'll start seeing significant investment in wetlands for the benefit that they provide for coastal resilience, but all the other benefits as well that we really have been taking more for granted in the need for the state.
What are the coastal climate change scenarios, and what would you recommend local governments need to prepare for, and how would you advise them on that?
I think what's happened is, while climate change has been occurring ever since we've had an Earth and a Sun, our present sort of awareness of it is fairly recent. And so I think we're still beginning to figure out how we're going to deal with this. And I think, a couple things to keep in mind. For about the last 8,000 years, sea level didn't change very much, and that just happens to coincide with almost the whole period of human civilization. So most of the world's biggest cities were built on shorelines for some obvious reasons, and now all of a sudden there are these threats, and however many millions there are, hundreds of millions living within a meter of sea level, 100 million, 150 million, there's some huge challenges, and California faces those also. And I think there's a genuine fear amongst many coastal property owners that they're going to be sort of regulated out of their property. And conversation we were having yesterday about, it's not really evacuation and condemnation, but it's sort of planning for what's going to happen in the future. And I think a big part of that is education, the need to involve local communities and the discussions that go on with some basic science, so they understand this isn't a left or a right wing plan to get them off of the coast so the rest of us can enjoy it. But there's some real serious things going on that are going to get worse over time, as Eric pointed out. And I think, in addition to sea level, when we're still in some ways measuring down to a tenth of a millimeter, we've got short-term extreme events that are going to be more important probably in the next 50 years, whether it's an El Nino or whether it's storm waves at times of extreme high tides. That's what's already starting to affect us. It's not a couple of millimeters. In the long run, that will be additive. So we can't focus solely on sea level rise, but we've got to focus on sort of how vulnerable our various areas of coastlines. And I think there's sort of a three-step process, I guess. One is to have each local community on the coast, which many of them have already done, begin to determine, delineate the areas that are the most vulnerable, whether it's flooding followed by inundation, those low-lying areas, and we know where many of those are, or whether it's coastal cliff and bluff retreat. Then I think we need some engagement between local property owners, dialogues, and information sessions, not just saying, here's what you got to do, but here are the issues, here's the science, here's what we know, here's what we don't know. And all of our sea level projections have uncertainties around them. So how do we get people involved so they feel like they're part of the process rather than just being told what they're going to do? And the third is then agree, I think, on some thresholds, or we could call them tipping points. How many times a year do you have to get flooded before you decide, okay, it's time to start moving something? How close to the sea cliff does your house have to be before you decide, okay, this is no longer sustainable? But I think bringing those people who have the most at stake into the process early on is going to be really important. And tell them it's not tomorrow, it's not next year for most people. It could be, for some people, 50 years away. Maybe your grandchildren can't live in your house, but you're going to be here for a while. So it's a transition. It's going to take time.
Madeline, do you have anything to add to that?
I guess a couple of things. I think it's definitely really important, as Gary said, to engage property owners and those that are, you know, directly affected by this. I think it's also extremely important to engage more inland communities, people that use the beach, those Californians that care about the coastline that is, you know, there for everyone. I think in order to have a balanced conversation, you need to hear from all of the stakeholders. And I definitely agree with this idea that we're talking about long-term planning. I think a lot of times, too, we're going to be thinking about phased planning. You know, things like beach nourishment, soft solutions may be a good solution for a while. You know, they're in many places in California will be many decades to start planning. And so the job for us now is to raise awareness and help communities engage in a visioning. You know, where do they want their community to be in 50 years, in 100 years? What do they want available to those future generations?
I just want to echo that long-term planning is really, for infrastructure, what we have to be doing. When we build a wastewater treatment plant or upgrade it, its life is 50 years long. So that's what they build it for. And if in 50 years, that's... it's not sustainable, then maybe now's the time to be building it somewhere else, as opposed to saying, well, this is going to be good for 35 years, and then 15 years we'll build a really big wall. Instead, maybe we can move it somewhere else, or maybe we can reduce the size of it by increasing smaller wastewater treatment plants upstream and using that water upstream. But the point I'm trying to get at is that it's too late in 50 years to think about the wastewater infrastructure. We have to think about it as we're rebuilding it. Almost all of our wastewater plants are reaching the end of their useful life. This is fortuitous time to be thinking through that infrastructure problem.
And I would just add briefly, in the importance of planning, there needs to be short, medium, and long-term actions within those plans, you know, so that's not just, oh, we're going to get to this, you know, when the next guy's elected or the next person's elected, but that there's actually going to be action taken under the current leadership that's not going to be super easy to reverse when you have the transition to new leadership. And that's something that I think is just absolutely critical, which is hard. Anything that's got this long of a time horizon is politically much more difficult than, you know, responding to an emergency, as Jonathan brought up earlier.
You know, we've heard some, you know, some vignettes and discussion about some work that the state has been funding or leading, but are there any other specific examples of coastal resilience that you could share that have been successful with the groups, and how does that exemplify what coastal resilience means to your organization?
It's a lot easier to find what isn't resilient than what is resilient. And I don't believe we should confuse rebuilding and repairing with resilience. That can be short term. We can sweep the sand off the streets in Imperial Beach, or let the tide go down along the Embarcadero in San Francisco. They're not really resilient, they're just sort of managing it for a while. But over the long term, as I look around, I'm not finding, because I think we'd all like to find an example, say, well, there's what somebody did, this is what we need to do. And I think it's because it gets into the long term of the magic words nobody wants to hear, managed retreat, or, as Dave Revel said, stepping back gracefully, which sounds much easier. And those are words I gave a talk to a group of coastal homeowners about 2 weeks ago, and the president who invited me, this is Santa Cruz County Coastal Homeowners, there's 500 of them, and he said, there's only two words you can't use. I said, what are those? And he said, manage retreat. And I went, oh, crap. How can you talk about the future?
In a new word, that means similar things.
So I think we're in this sort of interesting place looking for long-term solutions, looking for long-term resilience, but we haven't really figured out. I do know one place, if I had an image, I'd click it on the screen, but a couple years ago, I was working on this book on coasts in crisis, and we went down the Yorkshire coast of England, and I'd seen this book called Lost Towns of the Yorkshire Coast. What was that about? It was written 100 years ago, and they'd identified 29 towns and villages that had been lost since the time of the Romans on these low, very erodible coastal bluffs. They're glacial till, and it erodes at 2 meters per year for 2,000 years. And there's all these images of these villages that had fallen into the water. So I said, what's it look like there today? So today the land behind the shoreline is a low terrace. It's mostly cow pastures and hay pastures. But along the oceanfront, they have built dozens of mobile home parks. They call them caravans. Some are, they own, that's where they spend their summer vacation. They come there for a couple weeks out of the year. They're very low cost, average people, not multi-billion dollar coastal homes. And if you look at it on Google Earth, you can see all these concrete pads that are now empty on the oceanfront. And you get to live on the edge for 2 or 3 years, and then when the coast gets close, you just hook up a truck and move your trailer to the back, and somebody else gets a front row seat. I thought, brilliant, that's what I call a resilient program. And I think it's going to go over in California, particularly a place like Del Mar, however.
Yeah, I just wanted to give the example of the Morro Bay Wastewater Treatment Plant. We've been talking about wastewater a lot and potential future disasters. That was a case where, you know, they had an aging wastewater plant essentially on the dunes right behind the beach. The commission, I believe it was in 2012, denied the rebuilding of that wastewater plant and sent the community back through a multi-year planning process. And fortunately, they were able to relocate the plant inland. It is now in a place that will not be subject to coastal hazards in the future. They've incorporated many more sustainable features. They're reducing their reliance on the State Water Project water that they use. And so I think we are starting to see examples of where we are building more resilient infrastructure. And I think that is about investing in safe places and visioning the vulnerable places. You know, what is our vision for those vulnerable places in the future, and how will we phase adaptation there?
Anyone else have anything to add? Any examples?
I wish there were more. I mean, it was really looking for Gary to show us the way there. I was kind of bummed. All I can tell you is an example, again, using the safest one on wetlands, is that wetland restoration is going to completely change, you know, in that you're not going to see wetlands restored in a way where sea level rise is not taken into consideration. And we're seeing, you know, lots of experiments like at Seal Beach and elsewhere on, you know, you can really look at San Francisco Bay as being the biggest petri dish of how you're going to do wetland restoration moving forward. But that's going to be an example, you know, where the excess sediment's going to come from, so that you can actually build in, you know, some degree of resilience to sea level rise, so that those aren't just so you have actually tidal wetlands. Remains to be seen, but I could completely imagine that transition pretty much starts now.
So it's not really an example of coastal resilience, but it is an example of how sometimes it's not a disaster that you need. So I'm going to back away from that a little bit. you can have a confluence of issues that come together. The moving away from once raccoon plants in California was a confluence of a number of issues. It was clearly impacting the marine life, and that was where we came in from the water boards and wanted to reduce that impact. But at the same time, it was there was aging infrastructure that those power plants weren't really going to continue to limp along for very long and needed to be changed, and would have been changed as once through power plants without the water boards coming in at that point. And there was a desire to move away from fossil fuel, and it provided impetus to increase the investment in renewables. So having more than one driver helps, and you can, and agencies can get together and figure out ways to capitalize on what their problem that they see and join those together until, as Mark was describing, you have enough drivers to make it palatable to the people.
Just to add to that, the transformation in local water resilience is much more of an ongoing success story than obviously what's happened on the coast. And, you know, when you start seeing regions like Orange County and LA County and now even San Diego County, which have pretty much ignored sewage treatment for quite some time, you know, jumping into local water and getting to the point of they want to be less reliant on water from the Delta and water from the Colorado, that is a huge resiliency component, and there's a lot of benefits. It's not just climate resilience; it's earthquake resilience, and you know, you don't see very often. I think it's the only time in the history of the state. You know, LA County voted with 69.5% of the voters to tax themselves $300 million a year for stormwater pollution problem, as well as to get infiltrate more stormwater into the underlying aquifers, of which there's a great deal of capacity within the LA region. You're seeing commitments of literally could be $10 billion or more also in the LA County area to really look at coastal sewage treatment plants as water supply rather than a Clean Water Act compliance issue. And so it's that sort of mindset that really needs to be more comprehensive in really how we look at coastal resilience. I'm not saying it's the same as water resilience, but it is interesting and illustrative of the sorts of investments that are occurring right now in the state of California to build that resilience starting today rather than just focus on planning for tomorrow.
We built our water system based on where people want to live and where we want to grow food, not on where the water was. And then we engineered the water to bring it to folks. But we never finished that project, and I'm not suggesting that we should. We have had in the last, I'd say about 10 years, a slow but steady shift from the idea that the way to solve our water problem is to tap into another source of water somewhere else and bring it to the coast. The coastal areas are not water self-sufficient for most of the California, but there is opportunity, and we've talked about them in different ways this morning already, but they are essentially recycling of the water that we bring in, so that the perfect example is, we bring in all this imported water to LA, we use it once, we dump it in the ocean, and now we want to build desalination facilities right next door to bring it back around. Well, the thinking is changing that we can short-circuit that and use that water out of scalping plants upstream, even downstream at the end of the pipe. City of LA, LA County Sanitation District are both looking at going to essentially zero discharge, which is the idea of really taking that and then redistributing it. It's always been considered too expensive to pump water back uphill until people think about that we pump water uphill all the time. It's just from the Sierras instead of from Hyperion. And so that's one big piece of it. That's essentially reusing that water that costs so much from both energy and economics and environmental impact to bring to Southern California or to the coastal areas. But also, we are a flashy system, and we get lots of precipitation that comes very quickly, and then it's gone. And so we need to be able to have a flexible regulatory and infrastructure system that can capture that high flow event and store it for use when it's not there. And the best place to do that in Southern California is in the groundwater. We don't have evaporation, we've got space, and land is expensive. But it's hard to do because groundwater recharge is a slow process, and flashing systems are a fast process. So we have to think more creatively to capture it more diffusely than we're used to. We're used to building projects that are really big because we can quantify it. And the idea behind the county's proposition that for $300 million a year is that we can distribute some of that around the county and have lots and lots of smaller projects. I think that's the future. The idea that our stormwater system that's built to move water as fast as possible out of our communities and into the ocean is changing. That we want to move that water to a place where we can use it in the future instead of just getting it.